it is in doubt about faith or considers some faith, or if I can be more specific, considers Islam neither to be a true religion nor from God. One reason is the unawareness of the true teaching of Islam. Secondly, the evil deeds committed by some people make them even more dubious. As I said earlier, there is unfortunately a group amongst Muslims which commits foul deeds in the name of Islam, but this group is not even remotely connected to Islam because of their deeds. Those who do not believe in religion and deny the existence of God make religion the primary target for the lack of peace and go so far as to attribute this to the concept of God, even though there are many other reasons for this disorder in the world, as stated earlier. Then, as an Ahmadi Muslim, I believe that God sent his messengers to their respective people with moral and spiritual guidance so as to teach men tolerance, respect, and how to live at peace with other people. The messengers fulfilled their assigned missions. Finally, God sent Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessing of Allah be upon him, with the declared message that we have sent you not but as a mercy for all peoples. Chapter 21, verse 108. Therefore, it is inconceivable that the prophets, that a prophet who was sent as a mercy for all the people by the Lord of the heaven and the earth to share his bounties could bring a teaching of cruelty and spreading disorder. Nor is it possible that a God who sent such a prophet could be a God who should cause his creation to suffer cruelty and transgression. The prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a mercy for his friends and foes. It was his kindness and compassion that converted the backward and uncivilized Arabs, who neither had regard for relations nor any social responsibility, into a civilized people with high moral values. In fact, I believe that God Almighty revealed such a teaching that was to foster love and affection and mercy not only amongst the generations that followed him, but generations that were yet to come till the end of time, providing that they comply with this true spirit and do not confine themselves to the teachings, but adopt it in practice. The history of Islam is full of such noble examples. For instance, the most deprived and worthy of kindness individuals in Arabia were the slaves that every rich person of that time possessed. Before the advent of Islam, the slaves were treated in a most cruel way. After a hard day's labor, they were not even fed properly. In order to restore the rights to a deprived class and create a peaceful society, Islam advocated the kind treatment of slaves by saying that if you employ them for hard work, help them. Then in relation to the emancipation of slaves, the Holy Quran teaches, and what should make you know what the Aqaba or ascent is? It is the freeing of a slave. Chapter 90, verse 13-14. This action of yours against a deprived class whom you have subjugated and whose rights are being violated is disliked by God in respect of his creation. This is why in the do's and don'ts mentioned in the Holy Quran, and in some cases punishments or expiation has been prescribed, one of which is that if you have a slave, he should be set free. As for the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, he himself set free all the slaves he possessed long before his claim of prophethood. These slaves became indebted to him. One of them was Zayd. When his father and his other relatives came to take him back, he refused to go with them even though he was free and said, "I cannot leave the person who loves me so much and is so careful about discharging the rights of the poor people. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, advised the Muslims that if you wish to enter paradise, free the slaves. There are two benefits of this teaching. One is a means of entering paradise in the hereafter. The other is that by granting freedom in this world to a deprived class, you will be able to grant them the same status of a free man. This will remove the unrest within, because it is quite possible that if this unrest continues to grow in them, then a time will come when the slaves will fight for their freedom and societal peace will disappear. If a society is peaceful, it can be an example of paradise on earth, but the lack of peace can become a hell. Just look at today's society. When superpowers compel other nations to agree to their terms and conditions and effectively hold them in bondage, a time comes when there is a reaction against this bondage. Past history bears testimony to this, and the same is happening today. A society in which there is peace will look beautiful, but where there is fire and bloodshed, the same society will seem like hell. Today, the ways of enslaving and bondage have changed, but the underlying concepts of exploitation are the same. That conditions are imposed on weak nations and the developing countries in respect of debt provided as aid for their development projects so that they are permanently held under the yoke of slavery. We are witnessing the consequence of this unwise logic being suffered by the whole world. Therefore, the developed countries should help the developing world to gain economic independence. They should assist them so that they are able to utilize their own resources to enable them to stand on their own feet and thus strengthen their economy. When each country looks at another country and each nation looks at another nation as equals, the thought will never come to mind that we have to monopolize the market.